Thank you very much for the introduction, Don, and thank you, Laura Vogt, for the invitation to speak here today. At 1 p.m. on May the 7th, 1915, Captain Walter Schweiger, captain of a U-boat 20, a submarine in the German Imperial Navy, sighted a great passenger liner about 15 miles off the old head of Kinsale, off the coast of Southern Ireland. An hour and 10 minutes later, 2:10, U-20 fired one torpedo. 18 minutes later, the Lusitania sank with the loss of 1,201 lives, two-thirds of the crew and the passengers on board the ship. Among the people that died were 270 women and 94 children. And, as Dawn's already referred to, 124 Americans. The American public was shocked by this when it was reported in the American newspapers, and some national leaders expressed outrage at what had taken place. One of those was former President Theodore Roosevelt. Roosevelt, in an article published in the Metropolitan Magazine on May the 11th, just a few days after this, described this event as murder on the high seas. In the article, he also used the word piracy. Roosevelt said, firstly, that this attack on neutral ships defied every principle of international law, as well as breaching treaties with the United States that dated back to the early 19th century. And he said that the United States earns, as a nation, measureless scorn and contempt if it continued to follow the lead of those who exalt peace above righteousness. And he also recommended that the United States should act with immediate decision and vigor and do its duty imposed on the United States by its connection with the Great War. Now, these comments by Roosevelt were a thinly veiled criticism of President Wilson's current policy up to this point. In August 1914, when the war began in Europe, President Wilson said to the American people that he wanted the United States and the people in general to remain neutral in fact as well as in name, impartial in thought as well as in action. And this is the policy that Roosevelt was challenging. And then just a few days after the sinking of the Lusitania, on May the 10th, 1915, when President Roosevelt was addressing a body of people that were just swearing in to become US citizens in Philadelphia, he made the speech in which he said, "There is such a thing as a man being too proud to fight." And what he meant by this was that the United States was not going to be pressured into fighting a war because of some provocation from the outside. So the Lusitania, therefore, and the sinking of the Lusitania posed serious questions to this, serious challenge to this policy, Wilson's policy and his stance of trying to keep the United States neutral. And it raises, in terms of looking at what's going on in the United States, it raises a number of questions for us. First of all, what impact was the war having upon the United States in 1915, the second year of the war? Second, to what extent did the war intrude upon the everyday lives of Americans and the general public? Thirdly, how successful was the United States in maintaining its neutrality while the war raged in Europe and other parts of the world? And fourthly, was the country any closer to becoming embroiled in this global conflagration when 1915 ended than it was at the beginning of the year? In terms of answering that first question, in 1915, Americans were generally unwilling to enter the war, even after the Lusitania and other U-boat attacks, some of them actually targeted American shipping. And there are a number of reasons for that. The first main reason is that there were various ethnic groups and pacifist groups in the United States that vocally opposed American involvement in the war. One of the most powerful of these was the National German Alliance that was led by Charles J. Hexemer. This organization, set up in 1901, disbanded at the end of the war, this organization had 2.5 million members. And there were 8 million German-Americans in the United States around the time of 1915, which was just a little under 10% of the population. Hexemer and the National German Alliance, sometimes known as the National Bund, agitated for the United States to impose both an arms and even a food embargo on the Allies, because most of the trade taking place between the United States and Europe was with the Allies. And with regards to the Lusitania incident, the National Bund blamed the Royal Navy and said that the Royal Navy was to blame for this because they didn't provide adequate protection to the Lusitania as it was in the war zone that had been declared around Britain by Germany. Another ethnic group that was opposed to the United States, strongly opposed to the United States going to war as a result of the Lusitania, were Irish Americans. And there were 4 million Irish Americans in the United States. Now, one organization that was set up during this period, the summer of 1915, after the sinking of the Lusitania, was called the Friends of Peace. And this was an organization that was lobbying to keep the United States out of the war and to make sure it was extremely neutral. And this was essentially a German-American alliance. And so Germans, German-Americans and Irish-Americans were actually cooperating with each other in opposing the war. And they held rallies in various cities across the United States during this period. The Irish Press, for example, the New York Irish World, the New York Gaelic American, just days after the Lusitania, said the Lusitania was a floating arsenal. It shouldn't be viewed as a passenger and a civilian ship. And the New York Irish World said that the captain of the U-20 performed his patriotic duty in sinking a ship laden with munitions of war. And, you know, there was lots of talk about the fact that the Lusitania was actually carrying contraband, and there were about 5,000 cases of ammunition, plus some Canadian troops on the ship. Another viewpoint on this, from a German-American, again, is from George Sylvester Virek, who was the editor of a magazine called The Fatherland, which was set up the very month that the war begins, predominantly funded by the German government throughout the war, and in fact it continues after the war, and it has about a circulation of about 70,000 people per week. Virek actually blamed the United States. He said that the United States government had warned Americans to keep away from Mexico because it was unsafe there, so why didn't it warn them to keep away from the war zone that had been declared around Europe? And he said that if American ships weren't good enough for Americans to travel on, then they should stay at home, because traveling on a British merchantman was not a safe thing to do. As well as these ethnic groups, there were a large number of political groups that were opposed to the United States getting involved in the war. The American Socialist Party strongly opposed the war. This organization, in the previous election, 1912, garnered 900,000 votes for its presidential candidate, Eugene V. Debs, which was about 6% of the vote cast. The National Executive Committee of this party, as soon as the Lusitania was sank, declared that no disaster, however appalling, no crime, however revolting, justifies the slaughter of nations and the devastation of countries. They were clearly did not see this as a pretext for the United States to go to war, and the Socialist Party largely viewed the war as one between capitalist societies that workers had no interest in. And Debs, while he strongly condemned the Lusitania, called this a criminal destruction of the ship, he also remained committed to peace and opposed the United States declaring war. So the Irish and German-American ethnic groups, the American Socialist Party, were opposed to this, as was the Women's Peace Party that was formed in January of 1915. When this was formed, Jane Addams, the famous social worker who set up the Hull House Settlement House in Chicago, she was elected president, and the Women's Peace Party had a platform of neutral mediation. They wanted neutral powers, such as the United States, to mediate between the warring powers. They wanted international arms limitation treaties, and they wanted democratic control of foreign policy. So they criticized the fact that the war was being waged, and they definitely didn't want the U.S. to get involved to bring it to an end. And also, as might be expected, one of their aims was also they called for women's suffrage. Now, Adams went, traveled, and you can trying to figure out where the this is Adams here, just above the P and the E of the word peace. Adams traveled over to Europe, where there was going to be an international congress of women to discuss this issue at The Hague in the Netherlands. And she was, that's where she was when the Lusitania was sank, but she was actually in London just prior to going to the Netherlands. And that the objective of this Congress was that they would send delegates out to both the neutral and the belligerent powers and try to persuade them to establish or attend a mediation conference. Adams, while in London, said that, yes, public feeling is, of course, highly inflamed in the United States, but she sincerely hoped that the U.S. Would not go to war. So large number of groups then that were vocally opposed to the United States getting involved in the war. Now, British propaganda during the war, and particularly in the wake of the Lusitania sinking, definitely aroused sympathy for the Allies, but it did not undermine American resolve to remain neutral during 1915. At the beginning of the war, in fact, the very first day of Britain's involvement in the war, the cable ship Alert severed Germany's five transatlantic cables in the North Sea, which meant that Germany basically had no outside communication with the rest of the world, and then all news that going from Europe to the United States would come via Britain. Britain sent a weekly newspaper to 360 newspapers in the United States to make sure that they got a British viewpoint of the war. So the American view of the war was very much filtered through British newspapers. And all cables sent out from Britain to America were censored, and they had to be in the English language. So there was a great deal of control of information. And immediately after the sinking of the Lusitania, Viscount James Bryce issued his report, which he'd been engaged in for several months, on German atrocities in Belgium the previous year. This comes out on May the 12th, just a few days after the Lusitania, and it declared that there were deliberate and systematic organized massacres of the civil population. Innocent civilians, both men and women, were murdered in large numbers, women violated, and children murdered. Now, to the extent that the accuracy of this report has been disputed, but the key thing is that this comes out just a few days after the Lusitania. It's reported in the United States, and it carries weight because Bryce had previously been the ambassador, a very respected ambassador, to the United States. Now, despite all of this British propaganda pressure, a poll was taken of over 1,000 newspaper editors in the United States following the sinking, and though most of the newspapers condemned what happened, only 6 out of that 1,000 felt that the sinking of the Lusitania was a pretext for the US to go to war with Germany. So there was not, the Lusitania did not prompt Americans to believe that they should get involved in the war. And lastly, on this point about Americans not wanting to get into the war, even Wilson did not actually, he was not looking for a pretext to go to war. His protests over the sinking of the Lusitania were that he just wanted German U-boat attacks to cease. I don't have time to go into the details of his various kind of Lusitania notes that were written, the three of them written over the summer. But their end result was that in January 1916, the German government informs the State Department that henceforth it will strictly abide by international rules of maritime warfare, which was Wilson's objective. So, Americans were not keen to get involved in the war, despite the Lusitania attack. The second point that I want to make about 1915 in terms of the American attitude towards the war is that daily life in America was largely unaffected by the war. And the public continued to pursue their normal activities, including general leisure activities. Oh, by the way, this this poster here is one that it's a bond issue one that was created once the United States was in the war. But the reason why this was I've used this one is that these memories. Oops, I've gone blank there. Okay, we're going to have to quick trip through my slides. These this clearly shows that the British had left an impression on the American mind, because they're using those images from Belgium when they're doing a war bond issue once the United States is actually in the war. Now, the word normalcy is generally linked with the 1920s, when President Harding used that in his inaugural address. But it's very, if you look at it, in many ways, that normalcy that he was saying he wanted to get back to after the war was already emerging in the United States before the war. America's integrated consumer economy was largely immune to international trade disruption. U.S. railroad expanded from 500,000 miles to 50,000 miles to 250,000 miles between 1870 and 1917, making the United States the largest integrated economy on the planet. It didn't need trade with the rest of the world in order to survive. Yes, it could lead to a bit of a recession, but it could survive on its own. America was the industrial world leader by 1900. Growth in consumer durables, sewing machines, washing machines, telephones, automobiles, was driving consumer economy. And also, early in this period, becomes more important afterwards, the motor car. Henry Ford's 1 millionth motor car rolled off of the production line in 1915. The post-war economy was already in motion while the war was on. Incidentally, Henry Ford was strongly opposed to the war, and he organized what was called his peace ship, sailed out of New Jersey in early December 1915, and he said he was going to go over there, persuade everyone to stop fighting, and have those young men home by Christmas. What happened is that he was owned very soon after Christmas, admitting that it was a hopeless effort, and nobody in Europe was really interested, even those that were doing the fighting. By the press actually called it not the peace ship, but the ship of fools. In terms of trade, the U.S. was a net exporter from 1875 onwards, so it was no longer, importing was not so important to its economy. And 1914 and 1915 were extremely important for the U.S. in terms of its economy, because prior to 1914, the United States had always been a debtor nation. It borrowed more money than it loaned out. In 1914, the United States not only becomes a creditor nation, but it becomes the largest creditor nation on the whole planet. So the U.S. economy is largely immune from what's going on in Europe. The second point in terms of the impact of the war on the ordinary lives of Americans is the growth of commercialized leisure that's taking place before the war. It continues without hindrance during the war. Sport is one of the best examples of the growth of commercialized leisure. Baseball. Rumor has it there's a baseball team in this city. Baseball is becoming an extremely popular sport. In 1915, nearly 5 million spectators, 4.8 million people, paid to go and watch baseball games. This is the period in which baseball as a modern sport is kind of developing in the way that we know it now. In this World Series, the Boston Red Sox beat the Philadelphia Phillies by 4-1. Those of you that know a lot about sports will recognize this guy here. That is Babe Ruth before he moved over to the New York Yankees. And the reason I put him here is because this is also the age, not just of popular sport, but popular sport celebrities. I don't know one end of a baseball bat from another, but I've always known who Babe Ruth was. And that power of celebrity, that is being developed during this period. That commercialized leisure and this is already apparent before the 1920s. It's also a period in which popular music is becoming an important part of American life. The Victrola phonograph. We have a copy here with this is a wind-up phonograph. The electrical ones come in the 1920s. This was invented in 1906, but by the end of the war, sales of the phonographs and of records actually exceed sales of musical instruments, books and periodicals and sporting goods put together. And so there's a music revolution taking place during the war in the United States. And also in terms of music, this is 1915 is important because Jelly Roll Morton, one of the innovators of early 20th century music, he composes Jelly Roll Blues, which is the first published sheet music of jazz. So this is a very vibrant period. America is not just kind of looking across the Atlantic and worrying about what's going on there. It has plenty of distractions over here to keep it occupied during the war. In terms of the other great distraction, motion pictures. This is a phenomenal year. D.W. Griffiths creates The Birth of a Nation in January 1915. Now, there are lots of other issues related to this movie, but the important thing for us is that this is really the first major modern feature movie. Using the new technique of montage, where you split scenes and show different scenes from different angles. Griffiths produces a 12-reel movie that goes on for, over an hour or so, or several hours, in fact, in some of the, more than several hours. But the key thing is most movies around this time were only 3 reels long, and they only lasted about 15, 20 minutes. The modern feature movie is pretty much invented in 1915. This movie was the first movie to cost over $100,000 to make. It grosses $2.2 million, and these are in those dollars back in 1915, grosses $2.2 million in just that first year, giving Griffiths a net profit of $1 million. It's viewed within a few years by about 200 million people. So there's a cultural revolution going on in the US. It's very good at distracting people from what's going on in Europe. And later on in the year, one of the people that watched that movie, William J. Simmons, is actually inspired by this to create the second incarnation of the Ku Klux Klan, which goes on to have a great deal of influence in the 1920s. The other, Charlie Chaplin's Tramp character, it wasn't invented in this year, but this is the first year in which he comes out with a movie called The Tramp, and this is a key year for Charlie Chaplin. It's his directorial debut. By the end of the year, he was Only the head of U.S. Steel was earning more than Charlie Chaplin. So this is an age of big earning movie stars, and the star system is very much kind of emerging during this period. So all of those things, this kind of celebrity culture that we take for granted today and keeps us distracted from all those wars going on in other parts of the world, that was already taking shape here in the United States in 1915. And if that wasn't enough, there's also the progressive movement that's been going on since 1900. Progressive reforms caused much more domestic disruption in the United States than did the war. The two ones that draw most attention are the prohibition movement and the movement for women's suffrage. Prohibition of alcohol, and so that it was illegal to manufacture and sell alcohol in the United States, we all associate that with something that took place during the war and influences society afterwards. But even before the US enters into the war, the Anti-Saloon League, which was set up in 1895, has succeeded in making about 23 states in the US, almost half of the states in the US at this point. There were 48 states. 23 of the states were either entirely or partially dry. In 1913, the Webb-Kenyon Act makes it illegal to ship alcohol between wet states and dry states. So prohibition is already a key feature on the political agenda. And in 1913, just before 1915, the Anti-Saloon League ran a campaign to only elect dry congressmen. And so what they would do is they would rate congressmen, and they would run against anyone going for office. They'd say, this person doesn't support prohibition, don't vote for him. And this has a major impact on the composition of Congress after 1913. As well as the, this is an interesting advert. I didn't know what the age group of the audience would be, so I'm thinking if there were lots of young ones here, there's good message here. Drinking pairs scholarship, so don't go drinking, you'll get lower grades. As well as the prohibition movement, women's suffrage is another issue that's focusing the attention of Americans and distracting them maybe from what's going on abroad. 1913, Alice Paul sets up the Congressional Union. She breaks away from the regular women's rights movement, and she focuses on achieving national legislation through using the techniques of the suffragettes in Britain, who she'd worked with. And so that policy of women chaining themselves to the railings of the White House, that begins before, the ideas for that begin before the US actually gets involved in the war. And also in 1915, Carrie Chapman Catt is re-elected to the presidency of the National American Women's Suffrage Association, and she introduces her winning plan of trying to fight for women's suffrage at the state level, but also combining that with congressional influence and getting national legislation. So lots of the things that we associate with the war or just after the war were actually already in place here before the US gets involved in the war. Another reform issue that gains notoriety during this year is Margaret Sanger publishes magazine Family Limitation in 1914. This is a 16-page pamphlet describing birth control methods for women and also supporting the idea of defending the idea of abortion. In 1915, Sanger's estranged husband passes on this document to the New York Society for the Suppression of Vice, and they prosecute Sanger, and she's actually prosecuted and sent to jail as a result of this. So there are lots of controversies in the US that are keeping Americans focused on things other than what's going on in Europe. And just to note on this picture here again, these are women protesting. This is in Chicago, this picture, and they're saying, you know, Wilson a vote against is a vote against women. So you know, it's important for Wilson. He may be thinking about what's going on in the war, but he's also worrying about what issues are going to prevent him being elected in the forthcoming election of 1916. The third key point that I want to make then, so the US, Americans are generally not keen to get involved in the war. there are lots of things keeping Americans distracted from the war, and general daily life is more focused on these things taking place in the US. The third point that I want to make about 1915 is the American economy experiences a wartime boom that sets in motion demographic changes that have major consequences for the future. US exports are rapidly expanded during the First World War. In 1914, the US exports $2.3 billion worth of goods, and this goes up to almost quadruples to $8.1 billion by 1920. If we look at the industrial production index for 1915, these are, as you can see here, the economy was kind of slowly recovering from a recession in the set in motion from 1907. 1915, things start to pick up again, and things continue to improve throughout the war years. If you look at these percentages of growth, it doesn't look quite so impressive when you see that they're relatively high at the beginning. But we're talking about some of these years, almost 10%, and any modern economy would be happy with growth rates, even getting towards 5%, let alone 8 to 10%. So there's healthy growth in the economy. Farm incomes. There'd been a slump in American agriculture since the end of the Civil War, but farm incomes rapidly start to increase in 1915, and then they skyrocket up and towards 1919. And to demonstrate how odd this is, after the war ends, farm incomes start to drop again. So the war was very good for the American industry and for American agriculture. Now this demand for American goods also demands creates a demand for workers, and this demand for workers instigates a major shift in labor migration patterns in the United States. The war in Europe essentially cuts off the supply of European workers, as this graphically demonstrates. 1915, up until the beginning of the war, there have been record-breaking levels of immigration to the United States. Around 800,000 to 1 million immigrants coming in each year. Drops significantly in 1915, and so there's a drop in the supply of workers at the same time as there's an increasing demand. There's also a rise in strikes and lockouts during the war. Perfect time to organize a strike is when there's a great demand for your product and there's less workers to compete against. And the number of workers involved in those strikes grows during the war. So it's a period of industrial strife, and employers, they've got goods, they've got contracts to fulfill, and they want to make sure that they've got the workers to fulfill those contracts. So what happens is that Northern American, Northern industrialists look somewhere else to replace these European workers, and the place they look to is the American South. And that sets in motion the Great Migration. About 500,000 African Americans move from the South to the North, or to areas outside of the South, predominantly to the North and the Midwest, between 1915 and 1920. By the end of the 1920s, about 1.5 million African Americans had moved out of the South. Prior to World War I, black migration to outside of the South had not been as significant as this. And we begin to see a demographic shift. At the beginning of the war, 90% African Americans lived in the South. By 1960, it's under 60%. And that shift begins in 1915 itself. Now, and these figures kind of show the rapid growth of those populations in northern cities, Chicago, New York, Philadelphia. It's not quite so significant in these cities because they already had fairly large populations. But there were lots of other places, like Gary, Indiana, for example, where there weren't very large black populations before and suddenly grow phenomenally during the war. In the American Southwest, war production produces a demand for labor, and particularly in places like Texas, for example, where I've done my research on, the black emigration makes employers in Texas look around for another source of labor. Now, there's a long history of migration between Mexico and the United States, but the volume of immigration to the United States really picks up as a result of the First World War. And we see here the number of Mexicans in the United States is much larger by 1920 if we compare the growth compared to previous decades. So there's a massive movement of Mexicans into the United States, beginning with World War I, particularly Texas and California during this period. Now, this economic boom also led to a sharp rise in the cost of living. And that sharp rise in the cost of living exacerbated other social tensions. And we get one example of that, a very graphic example of that, in July 1917, with the first major race riot of the First World War I period. And it's a very violent period in terms of race relations in the United States. But the first major event in that is the race riot in East St. Louis. And this was predominantly triggered by tensions created by a sudden large growth of the black population, migrants coming from other regions, competition over jobs, use of black workers in order to destroy a strike by local workers in an area. And it was as a result of this violence that takes place in July 1917, about 6,000 African Americans actually fled East St. Louis to escape the violence. It causes $400,000 worth of damage, and there's a white mob attacks black neighborhoods, burning homes. So World War I, in terms of the demographic changes, it is the beginning of a new episode in U.S. history. African-American outward migration moving into Midwestern cities, race relations now being more of a national issue than an entirely southern one, and the beginning of the mass migration of immigrants from Mexico. So my fourth point. About the extent to which the U.S. is involved in the war. And my point here is that America was much more involved in the war than most Americans realized. And that involvement largely benefited the Allies, not Germany. Firstly, American financiers bankrolled the Allied war effort, and they even were engaged in organizing arms deals for the Allies. At the end of 1915, there were $1 billion worth of Allied contracts in the U.S., so American businesses supplying the Allies. J.P. Morgan was actually, J.P. Morgan Jr., we've got pictured here, was involved in both organizing the loans and also acting as a broker for arms deals. In fact, he got $13 million for organizing arms deals in 1915. And the pinnacle moment of this this development in 1915 is in October 1915, when the House of Morgan and various other financial bodies, but it's mostly brokered by the House of Morgan, they broker a loan issue, a loan to the British and French governments. It's a joint loan for $500 million. And so the U.S. is already heavily financially invested in the war. Now, from the point of view of Woodrow Wilson, who's thinking about 1916 and whether he's going to be re-elected, the forthcoming election dissuades Wilson from abandoning his kind of strict neutrality, or at least any pretense of it within the government. And this poll carried out by the Literary Digest in November 1914, the Literary Digest asks newspaper editors, A, what their opinion was on the war, and then B, what the mood was in the cities in which they published their newspapers in. And the evidence here is that most areas were pro-British, but many were either neutral or deeply divided in their sympathies. Here in the Midwest was one of the most deeply divided areas. Strong cities like Kansas City and St. Louis, for example, raised large German-American and large Irish-American populations. So going into the election on a pro-British stance was not necessarily a wise thing for Wilson to do. Not that he was going to do that, but he definitely wanted to make sure that he could maintain this idea. It appeared that the US was being neutral as well. And the National Bund, the National German-American Alliance, they were already gearing up for this election, and they were telling people not to vote for Wilson because he wasn't being impartial, he wasn't stopping American financiers funding the British war effort. And following the loans to the British and the French, the National Bund actually ran a protest in which they encouraged German Americans to withdraw money from those banks that gave loans out to the Allies. This protest was actually undermined, though, by the fact that Germany floated its own $10 million loan in America. So the idea that you should draw the money out to maintain neutrality didn't work so well. But this chart demonstrates, the vast bulk of the money going out of the country was going to the Allies. It was virtually nothing going to the Central Powers. Now, Wilsonian diplomacy also increased the likelihood of America entering the war on the side of the Allies for a number of reasons. Firstly, Wilson sent over various mediation missions to Europe, and these missions increasingly persuaded his aides that he was sending over there, people like Edward House and Robert Lansing, the Secretary of State, increasingly convinced these people that it was the Allies and not Germany that shared American values. So these mediation efforts were kind of preparing the way for the US to enter on the Allied side if it did get involved at all. Secondly, Britain's right to blockade Germany was not as strongly contested by Wilson as was Germany's submarine warfare. So it's another factor that was kind of his diplomacy was if anything guiding America towards supporting the Allies if it did get involved. And then lastly, these private loans were exempted from federal neutrality rules. So as long as there were private loan schemes being given out to the Allies, the federal government wasn't going to do anything about it. When the German government complained to American officials about this, they said, well, you know, we can't stop Americans giving loans or selling goods to anyone they want, and if you want to buy your armaments over here, go ahead and do so. And obviously that sounds all right, but the British blockade meant that anything leaving, bought by Germans and leaving, would probably have ended up in Allied hands. So America was actually involved in the war, even without having declared war after the Lusitania. My fifth and final point is that even if the United States was thinking about getting involved in the war, the US military was not ready for a war, definitely not ready for a major war, President and Congress were very slow to respond to calls for preparedness, the idea that the US should actually get prepared for a war. And so let's look at first of these, the US military. In 1914, the United States was lacking a large conscript army. And as a result, the US was less prepared for repelling a foreign invasion than any of the other major powers. And it's important, when I say this, the idea of repelling a foreign invasion, there is a preparedness movement that I'm going to talk about. And that is actually, that the whole idea about this is not about creating an army that can go over to Europe and fight in that war. It's actually about having an army that could defend America if it's invaded. But even in 1914, the US probably didn't have the military in order to prevent, to deal adequately with such a foreign invasion. Now, the Navy was the strongest point of the US military. The US had 31 battleships, and as a result, it kind of ranked about third or fourth in global powers. However, most of these were obsolete because European powers had introduced the all-big-gun ships in 1906. The Navy, the Army, however, it was a 100,000 volunteer force, was insignificant in size compared to the kind of armies of, in millions of some of the European powers. The United States was the only major power other than Great Britain not to have a large conscript army in 1914. Now, 1915 is significant in this debate over whether the US should have a war, should have a larger army, because after the Lusitania sinking, a preparedness movement in the United States starts to gain momentum. It had already been there beforehand, but people like Theodore Roosevelt very much promote this idea that America needs to be able to have an army that compares with, and a navy that compares with those of the great powers. And the leader in the United States of this movement was Major General Leonard Wood. He'd previously been the Commander-in-Chief of the U.S. Armed Forces and recently retired from that position. He's now the head of the Eastern Division, so his job was to prepare the east of the United States for defense against invasion. And Wood argued with regards to modern warfare, he said, "Modern war gives no time for preparation. Its approach is that of an avalanche and not of the glacier." So in other words, he's saying, we can't wait for war and then decide to build an army because we may have lost by then. We need to be prepared for whatever may happen. And then he also famously announced that I am out for national preparedness and I'm going to get it. And so he goes all out in this year to promote the idea of America enlarging the size of its military. And what he does, one of the things that he does is he sets up a military training camp in Plattsburgh, New York in August 1915. And this initially had 1,200 volunteers. They're mostly very affluent people from New York City and other parts of the East Coast, and they were at these training camps at their own expense. And the idea was that you could train civilians, give them a short course in military training, and then if everyone in the country had this, if there was a war, you wouldn't need to train an army because you've already got people trained. It's based very much on the Swiss model, which it continues to the present, I think, where everyone has to go through universal training and they're ready to join the military if there's a demand for the war. This movement, after Lusitania and after the preparedness campaign of 1915, gains momentum throughout the year, and by the summer of 1916, instead of the 1,200 people that he had in 1915, there are 16,000 people around the US. There were various Plattsburghs set up in other parts of the country, involved in unofficial military training, mostly at their own expense. President Wilson was initially opposed to, or definitely very cool on the idea of preparedness, but it gained momentum following the Lusitania sinking, and by November of 1915, he's actually publicly endorses the preparedness movement, and he asked Congress for spending to expand the military. He asked for the military to be increased from 100,000 to 142,000 standing army, and then also for 400,000 reserves. So in essence, a force that would be about 500,000, which is still significantly less than what the US prepared to send off to Europe in when the US actually gets involved in the war in 1917 to 1918. He also asked for $500 million to modernize the Navy and achieve parity with Great Britain by 1915. So it goes from a policy of not being interested in a large military to, by the end of the year, actually trying to compete with the European powers and, you know, the supreme naval power on the planet, compete with them by the end of 1915. So that's a very big shift in attitudes across a 12-month period. Oh, incidentally, Leonard Wood was Teddy Roosevelt's commander-in-chief in the Spanish-American War. He's his famous Rough Rider. So Teddy Roosevelt's son, Teddy Roosevelt Jr., was one of the major promoters of these Plattsburghs during the summers of 1915 and 1916. Now, this movement, however, was strongly criticized by some very influential politicians at the time. William Jennings Bryan, who had been Wilson's Secretary of State until he resigned after the second Lusitania note and was profound pacifist. William Jennings Bryan, his comment on the preparedness movement, he said it's not necessary for the United States to build a large army or to militarize the state. And he came up with the idea of building 12 coast-to-coast highways. And he said, all we need to do is, if we're invaded, ordinary Americans can get their rifle, get into their automobiles, and drive to whichever coast we're being invaded upon. And so, I don't think he realized it, but he inadvertently came up with the idea for the Interstate Highway Act as well. So Bryan didn't, he strongly criticized this. And another very influential critic was Senator Robert La Follette of Wisconsin, the veteran progressive reformer, and he argued that the preparedness movement, it was basically being pushed by profiteers, people in the who were in the armaments manufacturer, and they just wanted to create profits for themselves. One factor, however, that made it difficult for Americans to maintain their neutrality and sympathies during 1915 are the German espionage activities that increasingly became known public during this period. To be honest, I could have spent the whole session talking about what the German espionage activities going on in 1915 were, but I just want to focus on three individuals. First of those is a person called Franz von Rintelen. Now, von Rintelen was sent over to the United States with the specific purpose of organizing sabotage and anything else that could interfere with the war effort of the Allies. And he actually hired stevedores to plant a small bomb. It was sometimes called cigar bombs because it was shaped like a cigar, and it had two sets of chemicals inside that were divided by a small piece of copper, and the copper would erode after a certain amount of time, so you could plant this. They normally planted it around bags of sugar on their ships because sugar is highly inflammable. And a few weeks out, or a few days out into sea, the copper would dissolve, the two chemicals would meet, there would be an explosion, and ships would set on fire. Von Rintelen and his group were successful in creating lots of these fires on board ships, sending supplies to the Allies. So Germany was already fighting a war on American soil, even before the US was in the war. The other person to mention is Eric Munter, also known as Frank Holt, and he's known as Frank Holt to everyone in 1915. Now, Munter, I say, he's a very interesting character, but the thing that I want to draw attention to here is that he sets off a bomb in the Senate, and it explodes, and a few days afterwards gets on a train from Washington, D.C., travels down to New York, gains entrance to the mansion of J.P. Morgan Jr., and actually tries to assassinate him, shoots him twice, it gets him in the groin on one of the occasions, not fatally. And so so there's already activities going on. And then another individual called Anton Dilger. Now, von Winterland's activities and Frank Holt, Eric Munters, they actually become known during this period, but Dilger's weren't. But Dilger was actually in the US, engaged in germ warfare attacks on the US, and he came over from Germany with samples of anthrax and glanders, and he developed them in a laboratory that he had in New Jersey, and then these start to, there was an organized attempt to infect horses that would have been shipped over to Britain, because Britain was heavily dependent on American imports of horses during the war. And so that was actually going on. It wasn't until after the war that it was discovered that at least one individual in the United States died of anthrax as a result of this campaign. So there's already these activities were going on, and they came to the American public's attention when Dr. Heinrich Albert, who worked at the German embassy in the United States, or an employee of it, left behind a portfolio containing lots of information about this espionage network, particularly how it was funded, on a subway train in New York City. It was picked up by a member of the U.S. Secret Service who was following him, and so then it's passed on. Wilson gets to see this, and the number of people that are implicated in this were Johann von Bernstorff, who was the German ambassador. He was actually the titular head of the espionage ring. Franz von Papen, who was the military attaché, those of you who know your later history will know that he preceded Adolf Hitler as Chancellor of Germany. And also the gentleman we saw earlier, George Sylvester Viereck, who was publishing the magazine The Fatherland. As well as this, the Hamburg American Steamship Line, some of its agents were involved in the espionage that was going on. What does the US do with this? The Treasury Secretary, the head of the Secret Service, was William McAdoo, and he actually passes this portfolio on to the New York World, and so the information that goes out and the American public get to hear about this. And that seriously undermines Americans' ability to remain neutral in sympathies by the end of the war. So to summarize, yes, U.S. neutrality does survive the Lusitania crisis. Daily life, however, is largely unaffected by the war for most Americans, even though there are major changes going on. The economic boom in the US, however, does have significant consequences, particularly demographic ones, and they have long-term consequences way beyond the end of the war. Fourthly, American financiers were already closely bound to the Allied cause before the end of 1915. By the end of 1916, the Allies had $2 billion worth of loans in the United States. And fifthly, the White House eventually, by the end of 1915, commits itself to a military expansion program that at the beginning of the year it wasn't giving any consideration to at all. Thank you very much for your time.
So overall, one of the questions you posed at the beginning of the talk was the United States closer to war at the end of 1915 than at the beginning? And I was just wondering if you had a definitive answer to that, because it sounds like there's factors in both directions.
Now, I'm a social historian, so there's a kind of, you know, I'm looking at the impact of the war more on American society. And so in terms of the diplomatic history, I can't give a definitive a statement on that question. But in terms of whether, if the US does get involved in the war, which side it's going to go on, there's definitely a major shift. But by the end of 1915, if the US is going to get pulled into the war in any way, it's most probably going to get pulled into the war on the side of the Allies. The larger question about, is the US more likely to get involved in the war? I think that question is maybe going to be answered outside. If the Allies won in 1916, then the US isn't going to need to get into the war. But the longer the war goes on, the more that the Allies are borrowing money from American bankers, and the more the war might look imbalanced, then the greater the pressure is for the US to get involved in the war. So I think that whether the US gets involved in the war is probably going to be determined more by what's going on outside of the US in the war itself. But in terms of within the US, if the thing that changes is that if the US does get involved, it's most likely going to be on the side of the Allies. And that was not so clear-cut at the beginning of 1915.
I'd be interested to know if you have any information as to the intensity of British propaganda in the United States during 1915 and perhaps how effective it might be.
That's a very good question. And the general consensus on the role of British propaganda in America is that Britain didn't actually have a very organized propaganda campaign to the same extent that the Germans did. I mean, Germany did try to, kind of shape American opinion, whereas that Britain kind of had a hands-off approach. It controlled the access of information to the United States. It just passed on newspapers. You know, have a look at this, see what you think. You know, not trying. It kind of played. And the general British policy, and I'm not a British historian, even though I'm British. The general British policy was that if Britain had tried to go heavy with a propaganda campaign, that would actually made Americans less likely to support, so, you know, kind of alienated opinions. So Britain kind of played tried to do it with a light touch. I hope that answers your question.
Thank you.
And we have time for one more question. It's actually going to come from Mr. Brian Horgan on the other side of the auditorium.
I was wondering if you had any evidence about Americans paying attention or not to any of the other arenas that we've heard about today, such as Russia or Africa or the Far East, or if they were focused, as I suspect they were, largely on the Western Front.
Well, having looked at the newspaper coverage in this period, and I'd say when I'm looking at newspaper coverage in this period, I'm not really interested in the war very much. I'm interested in the impact of the war on American society, but not on the war. You know, all American newspapers, both the national ones and the local ones, are giving ample coverage to what's going on in the rest of the world, and it just kind of, you know, mixes it in there with other news. So the Americans are very well informed about what's going on. The issue is, to what extent are they prioritizing that information? Is it really, you know, is it really kind of having a big impact? And they'll turn one page over and they'll see the they'll see this, the news of what's going on in the world, and on the next page they'll see an advertisement for Rice Krispies. And one for Lucky Strike. There are lots of forms of information coming through newspapers, and it's hard to know where the American public kind of prioritize those things. And you know, it's mixed in with local news as well. But the one thing that is striking about this year is that the Lusitania was something. The sinking of that was something that really shook Americans and grabbed their attention. Before, the war didn't really touch the American psyche in a way that it did after the Lusitania sinking. So I think that had a much bigger coverage than some of those other arenas did.
Thank you.
Please join me in thanking.
Thank you.